You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, students. In this particular segment, we're going to deal with the 20th century U.S., what they called Indian policy. And so in this particular frame, if you can come up to the PowerPoint, we're going to understand and take a look at Indian policy as it evolved along the U.S. economic system. So I'll be providing for you the historical backdrop between for the policy itself, and try to appreciate how land policy evolved into based on the economic system of the United States at the time of its expansion. So let's go ahead and break into and understand and appreciate by going into the next slide let's take a look at three broad categories to appreciate the economic growth. And so what we have been learning in this class and we need to understand is this economic growth that has been happening within the United States. So between 1700 and 1815, there was one broad category. It was small-scale agricultural production and the rise of merchant capital. As the United States is going to expand its westward reach, it's going to be based on the demand by those who wish to follow what is known as the yeoman ideal. And there you'll see a picture of their notion of white notion of manifest destiny, that it was their God-given right by which to go from the East Coast to the West Coast. And the economic growth is based on small-scale agricultural production and the rise of merchant capital. And then as we've been learning in the class, we'll see that the United States, once after the War of 1812, the United States develops a rapidly expanding market economy. And so the market economy now is demanding land. And so between 1815 to 1860, we see the rise of the market economy. And this is, again, another category by which to encompass economic growth. And we can appreciate the experiences that Native peoples faced. And then finally, for what we're going to appreciate in the 20th century is the rise of industrial capitalism. Now, industrial capitalism goes from 1860 to the present, but industrial capitalism has its unique phases because it goes from, with regards to the scientific development of the productive forces, where by 1860, we're moving from steel, and steel is very important. That's a railroad industry as it connects markets. To aluminum, to plastics, as society urbanizes. So when you take a look at the foundation of any capitalist enterprise, its foundation of a modern nation today is based on steel, aluminum, and plastics. Then after World War I, the United States takes off into different modes of production based on the scientific development of the productive forces. And so we move from steel, aluminum, to plastics, which goes up to World War I, and then we move into what is known as the modern phase of where the United States moves into nuclear power. And it is from nuclear power that we have seen at each successive stage in the development of productive forces is the computer, the information highway, as we move as we move into what is known as the postmodern era, and we live in the postmodern era. So all of these are very important for Native American history because it determines the rate and pace of change that Native peoples are going to face as the United States moves west and as the United States takes over and expands its economy. So what's important to appreciate about this are there's two factors that affect policy decisions to go ahead and remove Native peoples, to expropriate Native peoples from their lands. And one, of course, is the availability of quote-unquote uncolonized territory. So the United States has, in their claims to the North American continent, there's a lot of territory that for them has been uncolonized. So for them, they look at U.S. policy interests, look at what it is that they can do to the lands that Native peoples inhabit. So the two factors that affect presidential administration's decisions by which how to deal with Native peoples is based on one, uncolonized territory, and then the other, the sources of demand for the land. The sources of demand we have seen in part of this course are the small farmers, most importantly are the land speculators, merchants, and in the 19th century, the railroad industry. And then today, it's in the 20th century, it's large machine industry, lumber interests, oil interests, mining interests, and then today, nuclear interests. So it's in order to appreciate Native American, U.S., quote-unquote, Indian policy, it's important to recognize how the land policy evolved along the U.S. economic system, that there are three broad categories by which to encompass economic growth, and that there's two factors that are affecting policy decisions to expropriate Indians, to expropriate Native peoples. So, of course, we have come into and appreciate, as we've taken through look at this course, that between 1700 and 1850, there was trade that both the colonies and the early America relied upon with regards to Native peoples. They made treaties with them. They made, and Native peoples were put on what Americans call reservations, what would be known as modern-day concentration camps. Native peoples were taken off of their subsistence needs and put into areas that could not provide for their subsistence. And this is one of the reasons why Native peoples are unique to other peoples is because the Native peoples have a special relationship with the federal government that no other groups have. African Americans, Chicanos, Asians, and poor whites do not have the special relationship that Native peoples have simply because of the treaty reservation or the treaty that Native peoples entered into with the United States. Native peoples, the federal government has a fiduciary responsibility by which to maintain Native peoples as Native peoples. Otherwise, if Native peoples were to disappear from this earth, then the United States did commit genocide. But the first we've seen in terms of their phases with regards to Native policy, these are the trade and treaty reservations. That's 1700 to 1815. Then in the next phase, we see a full-scale affront against Native populations, and that's 1815 to 1860, where we see the removal and the creation of reservations west of the Mississippi. So... This is the nasty phase, if, so to speak, with regards to Native American history, because all Native peoples east of the Mississippi are going to be removed west of the Mississippi. Now, there's pockets of Native resistance that are going to occur, so we still have Native peoples east of the Mississippi surviving, but not in significant numbers as in the west. And the reason why is because in this period, 1850 to 1860, removal occurs in earnest. And that's why today, Native peoples, Americans east of the Mississippi have never seen a Native American, have never seen a Native person. So in their imaginary, they only know them as mascots. So it's important to understand and appreciate this crucial period, because this crucial period is the genocidal period that the United States entered into. Then we'll move into and appreciate between 1860 to 2000, Four eras, and this is what it is that I'm going to share with you in this presentation, are the four eras. The first era that we'll take a look at is allotment. And allotment is very important. Between 1875 to 1920, this is a period where, after the genocide had been complete, now the United States has to deal with Native nations whom the Supreme Court has determined as and has identified as domestic dependent nations. So one of the most important that you'll be reading in the textbook is what is known as the allotment. This is known as the allotment period. And it's based on an act that was passed. It was known as the Dawes-Severalty Act. Now the idea, of course, after you have gotten rid of those Native peoples who are, those savages in the frontier in the Wild West, you know, this is the whole notion of that Wild West that needs to be tamed. It's a very racist notion, the notion of the frontier. This term pioneer, that is a very racist experience that Native peoples are going to have to face with peoples who come in to occupy their lands. So this word pioneer, this word west, this word frontier, this word wilderness, those are very racist concepts because it automatically subsumes that that whoever's out there is savage and whoever's within the borders of the frontier is civilized. So civility meets savagery. And so we have all of these words. So just watch it next time when you use the term, oh, I'm a pioneer. I'm pioneering. I'm blazing trails all the way to Portland. That's the racist notion that Native peoples, they've been here since time immemorial. These are their lands. They didn't need to pioneer. They didn't have no wilderness. So understand what lens you're using by which to interpret the occupation of Native lands. So the idea after all of the Native wars and after the Civil War, when the United States could finally fashion its economic growth, where Wall Street took over this country and organized the greatest massive economic growth in human history between 1875 to 1920, the idea was to turn Native peoples into small farmers by getting rid of collective ownership of land and introducing the concept of private property to Native peoples. And of course, because there is this attitude of superiority that Congress develops over Native peoples, and remember, Native peoples are being colonized, and so Congress has no, they view the Native peoples, especially those who resist, as modern-day terrorists. So Native peoples can't be trusted to become capitalists on their own. So the federal government is going to be a trustee of their lands as they leased their lands out for 99 years to private enterprise. So in effect, as you're reading in the textbook, it reduced the overall indigenous land base in half, further impoverishing them, and it reduced their lands to federal control. So when you really take a look at this allotment period, and one of the reasons why the act was passed, you're going to run into this one particular man who's very famous today. His name is John D. Rockefeller, because in effect, John D. Rockefeller, who encouraged this act to be passed, is going to take over the oil reserves that they found beneath the Osage lands in eastern Oklahoma. It allowed John D. Rockefeller to extend his holdings for a corporation that would eventually become Standard Oil, that you know today as Chevron or ExxonMobil. So the idea was you had a reservation. It was collectively owned by Native Americans in perpetuity by the federal government and the treaty reservations. But the idea was to break apart those reservations and give each Native person an individual plot. And so each Native person would have a plot, and then the federal government would then lease that plot to private enterprise for 99 years, at sometimes a penny an acre, and then, of course, that would be enough to keep the Native person subsisting so that, you know, they didn't commit genocide. They're still around. However, they're living in abject poverty. But the idea was to get to Native people's lands. And this was in Oklahoma. These were the lands that the federal government had given to them as they removed them from eastern United States. So this Allotment Act was a means by which to even go after what they had already set aside for Native peoples that had been removed from eastern United States. So any lands that were remaining, let's say there was 100 acres that these Native peoples owned, so they're going to dole out these acres to each individual member. And then whatever lands was left over is going to be opened up for white settlement. And so any lands remaining after allotment became open to white settlement. So in essence, when you take a look at Oklahoma history, Native American Oklahoma history, Native people in Oklahoma are going to lose their lands as whites are going to eagerly take up the lands that are going to be available after allotment. And one of the things that was interesting about Oklahoma is that they had set a specific day for white settlers to go in and go again in and on a first-come, first-served basis go and occupy the lands. So what happened was the white people couldn't wait for that day, and they went in immediately to go in and occupy the lands. And they didn't wait for the day that the lands were going to be open for settlement. So they rushed to occupy the lands before the date set for the settlement, and hence the moniker Oklahoma Sooners. So even that mascot, Oklahoma Sooners, should share with you something about Oklahoma and the state of racist expansion that Oklahoma white settlers did with regards to Native peoples. Now, the government funds from these indigenous land sales, or the royalties that the federal government received, were supposedly held in trust, and they're going to be managed in Washington under the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And of course, these funds were invested in railroad companies and municipal and state bonds, and the monies that were made were never given to Native peoples, as we will find out later, as you will read later in the textbook, on how Native peoples had to take the U.S. to court, the BIA to court, to get the monies that they had always had for Native peoples. I think it was in the billions of dollars now the settlement occurred. So really, the federal government stole treaty-guaranteed funds and then allotted lands to private enterprise. Then we've learned about the boarding school era. The boarding school era was about assimilation for the Native populations. In other words, you go after the children. And one of the most important things is, of course, when you go after the children and you educate them in U.S. In the U.S. system, then the idea is to convince the children of the U.S. version of history. So, again, it's very important to understand, if, especially if you're a person of color, especially if you're a minority, if, and especially if you're Native American or African American or Chicano or Asian, once you accept their version of your history, you're conquered. So understand, again, the colonial mentality. It's very important to appreciate. Okay, one of the things that happened is that by 1920, the census revealed that Native peoples were not statistically relevant as a population. And so if they're not statistically relevant as a population, then they are no longer a threat to American society. So by 1920, Native peoples, we're going to see why it's going to be easy for Congress to finally grant them citizenship as a means by which to make assimilation complete. So now we don't have the Native problem anymore. They are a statistical irrelevance. What they do now is, one of the things about the American identity is that the American identity needs to be connected to the land, so now Americans can become Native. And so they have the mascot. Oh my gosh, so you have the lions, the tigers, and bears, and Indians, oh my. And so it's very nice that the Native peoples become mascots, because now you can become part of them. Oh my gosh, so that's why you have white people all over the place claiming that they're Cherokee. All of a sudden now they become Native. Whites become Native, because that's one of the means by which for them to finally secure an identity rooted in the land. It's yes, of course. Oh yeah, my great-great-great-great-grandfather was Cherokee from Idaho. Anybody who says that knows that the Cherokee are not even from Idaho. The Cherokee are from the eastern part of the United States. So let's appreciate again this whole notion. In the 1920s, Native peoples became mascots in the American imagination. And so, of course, Native people still continue to be a part of that American imagination. What's going to happen, very curiously, is there's going to be this report that's going to be finally the first general study of Native American conditions since the 1850s. An ethnologist and former U.S. Indian agent named Henry Schoolcraft is going to complete a 6-volume work for U.S. Congress, and it's going to be known in 1928 as the Merriam Report. Now, what the Merriam Report is very important to appreciate is that it provided the data that's going to be used to reform Indian policy in the next phase. Because what we're going to look at the next phase after allotment is the passage of the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934. But the Merriam Report is important because it influenced succeeding policies on land allotment, education, and health care. And the report found generally that the federal government failed at its goal of protecting Native peoples, their lands, and their resources, both their personal and their cultural identities. So that gets us to the next phase, which is known as consolidation. And with the Merriam report comes the notion that perhaps Native peoples need to be protected as special citizens. And so by the 1930s, with the Great Depression and movements for change demanding that the federal government do something about poverty, a socialist named John Collier became Commissioner of Indian Affairs in 1933 and implemented progressive policy that eventually became known as the Indian New Deal. And the best part of the New Deal was the termination of both the Allotment Act and the boarding school program. Now, the new act ended allotment, and it permitted Native nations to organize their own governments and to incorporate their trust lands communally. So allotment ended. The controversial part of the legislation, which was known as the Wheeler-Howard Bill, which became the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934, was the creation of quote-unquote tribal governments. Now again, this notion of tribal means that the federal government is not recognizing them as sovereign nations, but rather as domestic dependent nations. They're tribal governments under the influence of the federal government. It was a gesture towards self-determination, but it allowed for the creation of a managerial class of Native Americans that were sponsored by the United States. So it was an elite class of Native peoples who became enriched, and they, in essence, undermined the traditional forms of government, and this undermining continues to this day. That's why in Native politics, Native American politics, you can see the different kinds of factions that are running reservations. One on behalf of corporate interests that control through the Department of the Interior. And you have to remember that the Bureau of Indian Affairs is not a separate department. It is part of the Department of the Interior. So the Bureau of Indian Affairs has to compete against the Department of Forestry, the Department of the National Parks, okay? Everything that comes under the rubric of the Department of the Interior. Native Americans come under that umbrella. And so it's going to be political by which to see how funds move through the different funds are allocated from the Department of the Interior, because the Department of the Interior, Native peoples have to compete with all of these other departments. So the Bureau of Indian Affairs is just but one part of the larger Department of the Interior. But it's through the Bureau of Indian Affairs that they control, quote unquote, the tribal governments. And this became the problem, all right? Elders' councils were replaced by opportunistic politicians. And this was the Indian New Deal. This was consolidation. The nation that's going to lose the most from the New Deal are going to be the Navajo. As you can follow through on the textbook, because the textbook shares with you how their sheep industry was devastated in favor of New Mexico and Arizona agribusiness interests. New Mexico and Arizona agribusiness interests prospered at the expense of Navajo sheep grazers, or the Navajo sheep industry. Which leads us to the next phase after World War II was known as termination. And after World War II, anti-democratic forces swept through Washington, D.C., and there was a groundswell of anti-Indian sentiment that permeated Congress. The idea was, of course, by conservatives, is why should anybody have access to the federal dole? Why should the federal government be subsidizing people? The federal government is about making sure that businesses make money, never about assisting people. And so because the New Deal had guaranteed the regular population, Social Security, the Fair Labor Standards Act, a 40-hour week, aids to families with dependent children. These were programs that conservatives don't like, because it means that a lot of people are just getting federal monies and not doing anything about it. But the idea was behind the New Deal was that because of the tremendous poverty during the Great Depression, the New Deal was sharing with people that it wasn't your fault that you're poor, that the federal government will help you and make sure that you can maintain your subsistence. Well, this is what the United States needs to do with Native peoples, because the treaty-making process, Native peoples, the federal government has a fiduciary responsibility to maintain their existence. So you know when conservatives come to power, they're going to go, what the hell is this? How can the federal government be subsidizing Native peoples? So the federal government wants to wash its hands from any kind of responsibility to Native peoples. So two programs were created. The first was to get rid of reservations once and for all, and to settle once and for all any Native ancestral claims to land, so that the federal government could just say, hey, we're going to take care of the Indians right now. We're going to pay them what supposedly we did to them, and then we'll get them out of the way. And this was the attitude. And so they created what was known as the Indian Claims Commission. And the Indian Claims Commission was empowered to settle lands taken illegally by the federal government and to compensate Native peoples based on the property's value at the time of the taking, without interest. So, and then to add insult to injury, any expenditure made by the federal government on behalf of the Native nations was subtracted from the overall award. So when you take a look at the commission and the Claims Commission reports, when you take a look at the Claims Commission reports, it is an amazing collection of reports from throughout the nation on those areas that were precisely, those reservations that were precisely attacked by which to get after their land base. The Indian Claims Commission itself enriched anthropology departments throughout the United States. Anthropology departments, many anthropologists made their names from major universities throughout the United States, got this money so that they could go in and make their history, put their imprint on the historical record of Native America. So when you take a look at the Indian Claims Commission reports, they are amazing reports, and many of them still need to be challenged to this day, because they were erroneous in laying claims to ancestral Aboriginal land rights. But nonetheless, the commission nonetheless at least recognized that the United States committed genocide, that the United States illegally took lands from Native peoples. But as Congress weakened the federal trust responsibility, and the policy trend was, of course, let's get the Native peoples out of the process, let's assimilate them. And the idea, of course, is to introduce blood quantums, that the only way that you can maintain yourself as a Native American is that you have to maintain a blood quantum. And the idea, I think, for reservation is that as a Native person, you have to have 1/8 a degree of blood by which to be registered. Well, this whole notion of blood quantum is designed by which to eventually eliminate the Native American. And so this is the problem that Native Americans have, and they have to face today in the colonized minds, is when you take a look at a Native person, well, if you don't look Native, well, then how are you Native? And so, of course, the blood quantum, I mean, this impacts psychologically all Native peoples, because you're not going to be federally recognized unless you have 1/8 blood of Native heritage. And so this does tremendous damage recognizing the struggle for that Native peoples face today, just to be acknowledged as Native American. So Congress is going to introduce what is known as the Termination Act of 1953. And under this act, the federal trust protection and transfer payments previously guaranteed by treaty and agreement are going to come to an end. This is known as a relocation program. And guess what? The person that was brought in to guide this program, his name was Dillon Meyer, and he had experience during World War II in supervising the relocation of the Japanese into concentration camps. So what a better person who's already used to committing genocide, especially against the Japanese during World War II, when they were taken away from their homes and put into concentration camps. What a better person to direct the relocation program of Native peoples, to move them out of their modern-day concentration camps into urban areas. And so this is where we get the first move of Native peoples out of the reservation and into urban areas. The 1956 Indian Relocation Act sent Native peoples into industrial urban centers such as San Francisco, here in Los Angeles. Los Angeles is the major place where most Native peoples were removed or relocated to. There's Denver, Minneapolis, Phoenix, Dallas, Cleveland, Seattle, Oklahoma City. Many times, there's many different stories with regards to termination, how Native peoples were just dumped into the city, given a few bucks and told, go survive. They were just dropped off and fend for themselves. So this was known as the termination period. Yeah. So now let's move to the next phase, which is known as resistance, self-determination, and underdevelopment. Now, it was the experiences with termination that a group of resistance leaders emerged to form what became known as the National Council of American Indians in 1944. And through their advocacy, the federal government is going to be challenged to cease termination, which was finally repealed in 1988. Now, over 100 Native nations had been terminated, and the struggle for recognition began in earnest in the 1960s. It was in this period that Native organizers began pushing for what is known as self-determination and restitution. So let's understand this clearly. By making a treaty with the United States, Native peoples are recognized as a sovereign nation. After all, this federal government is making a treaty with Native peoples. And so in the Constitution, only the federal government is empowered to make treaties with foreign nations, with sovereign nations. State governments cannot enter into treaties with Native peoples. So the federal government is the one that made the deal with Native peoples. So states who have reservations in their within their domains do not like the idea that there's a separate sovereign nation within their states. This is the notion of territorial integrity. States don't like their territory to be broken up into sovereign places. The federal government, only federal laws apply on Native reservations, not state laws. And this is very important to understand, especially because by making a treaty with the United States, then Native peoples recognize they're sovereign. So they can make, they have the power to determine for themselves what happens on their lands. Hence, they have the power to determine as well and to ensure that the federal government lives up to its fiduciary obligation to maintain the subsistence existence of the people. This is very important. So the National Indian Youth Council, as you're going to be reading in the textbook, was developed by 26 Native activists and students from 21 different Native nations, and they organized in 1961 in Albuquerque, New Mexico, to demand sovereignty and to protect treaty rights. In 1964, they organized support to protect treaty-guaranteed fishing rights in Washington, where one of the most important actors of the 20th century, Marlon Brando, took an interest. And Marlon Brando himself provided support and publicity to their cause. These were known as the fish-in movements, where Native peoples developed fish-ins, and they caught the attention of the American public. Marlon Brando continued his support of the Native movements for change throughout his career and up until his death. Now, you're going to be viewing an interview that Dick Cavett had with Marlon Brando on his controversial Native American stances with the Hollywood film industry. Please watch that so that you can appreciate the significance of this icon in American Hollywood. Then in November 1969, a dramatic seizure and an 18-month occupation of Alcatraz by a group known as Indians of All Tribes caught national attention as Native American students and community activists are going to build a thriving village on the island, and they're going to attract national and international support. Now, you can read their proclamation in the textbook for the course and view the occupation in the link that's going to be available to you so that you can understand the occupation of Alcatraz. Now, after the forced evacuation of Alcatraz in June 1971, the University of California, Davis, through the leadership of indigenous professors Jack Forbes and David Risling, are going to establish a 2-year Native American Chicano College and Movement Center. The name was DQU, and it was founded to address the specific needs of both Chicanos who were reconnecting to their native past and Native people's sovereignty rights. Now, Joshua Frank Cardenas, writing in Tribal College, a journal for Native peoples, informs readers in an article where he traced the rise and fall of DQU that the name, Deganawada Quetzalcoatl, embodies a unification of two struggles, that of the Red Power and the Chicano movements. Now, Deganawada Quetzalcoatl University. Deganawada, or the peacemaker, was a prophetic Huron who, according to some stories, was born from virgin birth, had visions as a young child, and took the faithful voyage in a stone canoe to bring a message of peace to the many warring nations. And together, the warring nations created the Iroquois Confederacy, or the Haudenosaunee, the people of the Longhouse. And it bound the peoples in every way to a great law of peace, strength, and righteousness. Now, you became familiar with that by the Haudenosaunee by watching a documentary on what happened to the Haudenosaunee during the American Revolution. So this great law, forged through a maternal matrix of relations, has withstood the test of time, invasion, and imperialism, according to Joshua Frank Cardenas. And meanwhile, he writes that the feathered serpent Quetzalcoatl, as known to the Mexica or Guacumat or Gucamats, Kukulkan to Mayan peoples, was a creator spirit or Teotl, and it was related to the wind, the arts, learning, and knowledge. The spirit was the patron of the priesthood, and he invoked as the knowledge tradition behind Mexica higher education system, the Calmecac. Now, Quetzalcoatl was also associated with Venus, farming, and fertility, and is still revered in many Nahuatl communities today. So there is a prophecy, originally from the Amazon, and now incorporated within the Chicano movement, that speaks of a unification of the eagle and the condor. The eagle representing North America and the condor, South America. DQU continues to serve the community. Now there is the occupation of the Bureau of Indian Affairs in 1972 and the siege at Wounded Knee of 1973 that's going to catapult the American Indian movement into the national and international limelight. So instead of describing these events in detail, I made available to you two documentaries and a movie featuring John Trudeau addressing the issues raised back in the 1970s. But instead, I will briefly describe these events by reading to you passages from the course textbook that are found on page 185 and 186. So please bear with me here as I share with you a very important passage on the American Indian Movement and the shirt that I wore today. When the Vietnam War still raging and re-election of Richard Nixon in November 1972 imminent, a coalition of eight indigenous organizations, AIM, the American Indian Movement, the National Indian Brotherhood of Canada, later renamed Assembly of First Nations, the Native American Rights Fund, the National Indian Youth Council, the National American Indian Council, the National Council on Indian Work, the National Indian Leadership Training, and the American Indian Committee on Alcohol and Drug Abuse organized what was known as the Trail of Broken Treaties. Armed with a 20-point position paper that focused on the federal government's responsibility to implement indigenous treaties and sovereignties, caravans set out in the fall of 1972. The vehicles and number of participants multiplied at each stop, converging in Washington, D.C., 1 week before the presidential election. And hanging a banner from the front of the Bureau of Indian Affairs building, they proclaimed it to be the Native American Embassy. And hundreds of protesters hailing from 75 indigenous nations entered the building to sit in. The BIA personnel, at the time largely non-indigenous, fled, and the Capitol Police chain-locked the doors, announcing that the indigenous protesters were illegally occupying the building. The protesters stayed for 6 days, enough time for them to read damning federal documents that revealed gross mismanagement of the federal trust responsibility, which they boxed up and took with them. The Trail of Broken Treaties solidified indigenous alliances, and the 20-point position paper provided a template for the affinity of hundreds of Native organizations. 5 years later, in 1977, the document would be presented to the United Nations, forming the basis for the 2007 UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And 3 months after the BIA building takeover, Oglala Lakota traditional people at the Pine Ridge Sioux Reservation in South Dakota invited the American Indian Movement to assist them in halting collusion between their tribal government, formed under the terms of the Indian Reorganization Act, and the federal government that crushed the people in further impoverishment. They were opposed to the election of a tribal chairman named Richard Wilson, and they invited AIM to send a delegation to support them. What's going to happen is a 2.5 month siege of protesters at the 1890 massacre site of Wounded Knee. And the late 20th century hamlet of Wounded Knee was made up of little more than a trading post, a Catholic church, and the mass graves of hundreds of Lakota slaughtered in 1890. Now armed personnel carriers, Huey helicopters, and military snipers surrounded the site, while supply teams of mostly Lakota women made their way through the military lines and back out again through dark of night. So I just wanted to share with you the significance of what's being covered in the textbook. Now you're going to go and watch the documentaries that I'm going to be providing for you so that you can understand the significance of the American Indian Movement. Now, as the FBI, through its counterintelligence program known as COINTELPRO, infiltrated the American Indian Movement and either assassinated or incarcerated its members, activists decided to go international and created the International Indian Treaty Council. This gave movement members voice internationally at a very crucial time when repression nationally was the norm. The United Nations gave the American Indian Movement the space that they needed to pronounce the quest for self-determination and restitution. The IITC received UN non-governmental consultative status in 1975, with its first conference held in 1977. Now, all of the UN mandates since the 1970s eventually led to the acknowledgement of violation by governments in the Western Hemisphere, in the Pacific, and in the Caribbean Islands, and in Australia, because the International Indian Treaty Council now brought together all Native nations from the Western Hemisphere, the Pacific Islands, and the Caribbean. And Native peoples now had a voice by which, or a space by which to voice their concerns about their sovereignty and about their land base. And this became very important because, as stated in the textbook, the global indigenous cause reached a major milestone in 2007 when the UN General Assembly passed the Declaration of Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And the only four members of the UN Assembly that voted in opposition to it were, of course, the United States, Canada, New Zealand, and Australia. And as Dunbar Ortiz emphasizes, all of them were Anglo-settler states. They did not acknowledge the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. So the most important action by the UN was the completion of the UN study on treaties in 1999. And this study was the most appropriate way to end the century of theft and genocide, because this study concluded that treaty rights in the United States do have contemporary effective status. So that is the end of this particular presentation on the 20th century.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.